So now we're gonna have like Domenico. He worked on forecasting for models. He has also worked on dynamic factor models.
Thank you. It's a great conference. Congratulations to the organizers, and thanks a lot for having me here. So this talk is about nowcasting. And let me see. So what is nowcasting? We have already heard about that. So it's a contraction, a strange contraction of two terms, now and forecasting. And this concept has been used in, for a long time in meteorology. Actually, in meteorology, since 86, I think is the first time I've heard about this term. And it refers to the forecasting, the weather, up to 6, 12 hours. It's a very, very short-term forecast. However, in economics, this concept of nowcasting has been introduced only recently. And actually, this is strange because, you know, forecasting in economics is much more difficult than forecasting weather. You know, you can look out your window and see whether it's rainy or it's sunny. In economics, instead, we have to wait a long time to see what is the situation. And so, for example, in the United States, we will have the first stage. We are in the second quarter of 2013, and we will have the first estimate about it at the end of July. We have to wait another 4 months before having an estimate. For Europe, this is even more more difficult. We have a longer delay. We have to wait until mid of August in order to have an estimate of where we are now. In Brazil, we still don't have the estimate for the first quarter. So we have to wait, I think, until the end of the month in order to know where we were last quarter. So this led me to define nowcasting as the forecasting of the near future, let's say next quarter, the present, this quarter, and even the recent past, last quarter for the case of Brazil. So this presentation is going to be about, is based on a And this is typically done using formal economic modeling on the relationship between key macroeconomic variables. Think, for example, of the traditional, let's say, a small-scale macro model. You have consumption, investment, GDP, hours, everything typically measured quarterly. And typically the forecast is for next quarter or some few quarters ahead. And these forecasts are done using formal modeling, like vector autoregressions, like factor models, dynamic stochastic general equilibrium model. So here, really, the econometric techniques are used at their best. However, when you move to shorter-term forecasting, what you tend to see is that these forecasts are typically based on simplified heuristic scrutiny of many variables, so variety of conjunctural indicators. And typically, these are indicators that the typical macroeconomists don't look at. For example, survey data, or weekly claims, or all this consumer confidence. So these are all indicators that we typically, as macroeconomists, don't consider. And the way they are used are also don't exploit the kind of models, state-of-the-art modeling techniques that are typically used for longer-term forecasts.
And another feature when you look at forecasting is that, you know, the forecasts are typically updated infrequently. So, for example, I think the most frequent forecasts are done at central banks. Typically, forecasts are done every quarter. In the United States, every time there is a round of the FOMC meetings. In Europe, it is done every quarter as well. Other institutions, for example, the OECD, the IMF, they produce the forecast only twice a year, so semi-annual frequency. And so this during this talk, what I'm going to discuss are the following questions that raise when you start thinking more deeply about the problem of nowcasting. And so the first question is, obviously, how important is nowcasting relative to longer horizon forecast? So I remember one of the first comments when I was presenting the first result about nowcasting in central banks was like, you know, but in central bank we care about the longer horizon, like 1 year and a half, who cares about now? So we are gonna address this question. The second one is, let's suppose it's important, okay? And then can we predict it? Okay, so can we make a nowcast that is based on formal modeling without informal judgment? And finally, the last question is, how relevant is this conjunctural information, this data about like surveys and consumer confidence and so on? And related to this is, how often should we update our forecast? So does it make sense to wait every quarter or to do it only twice a year, or there is some value added in updating it every day or every time new data arrive? So first question, how important is nowcasting relative to longer horizon forecast? So this is a table where I compare forecasts produced by judgment. This is GB. The first line refers to the Green Book, is the forecast prepared for the FOMC meeting by the Fed staff. And the other line refers to the Survey of Professional Forecast. You know, Philadelphia Fed every quarter does a survey asking professional forecasters what they think about different variables in the future. And then you can average them. That's a consensus. And here I report a way of evaluating this forecast is mean squared forecast error relative to a naive model. So mean squared forecast error is really the outer minus what was predicted, you square and then average. And you compare this measure with the measure that you know, a simple model would have made. This is a forecast that my grandmother would have made. Like, it's a constant growth. So in the case of the United States, constant growth is, you know, GDP growth is 2% every quarter. Okay. And numbers larger than one mean that, you know, the Fed staff is worse than my grandmother in forecasting. Numbers smaller than one means that they are better. And here you can see that only at zero you have a number that is smaller than one. So I hope that this convinces you that the presence is the only horizon of predictability. There is unpredictability beyond current quarter. And this implies that our macroeconomic projections are strongly rely on the accuracy of our starting conditions. So this result don't mean that, you know, projections are useless. They are useful in order to organize, to understand the relation between macro variables. However, this result tells you that the accuracy will depend strongly on doing a very good job in the present. And actually, in that case, you could do it using judgment. So the next question is, how can we do predict the present? Can we make predictions that are comparable with the one made by, you know, this, the Fed stuff, there are many people doing this. They discuss, they construct their forecasts using judgment. These are lot of this is done by sectoral experts, and the same for the survey professional forum. There are many forecasters, each of them has their judgment, you average them, and so on. So the question is, can we replicate this with a machine? Can we replicate this expert judgment with a machine? Actually, this is a, it was, this is a book about Moneyball. So it's about replacing expert judgment in the hiring in the of a baseball team, replacing it with an algorithm. And okay, so this this is a picture. There is a, they made a movie out of it, and this is a picture with sectoral experts. Okay, and this is the computer algorithm. This is a nerdy computer guy that is trying to program an algorithm in order to replace this expert. So I'm gonna play the role of the nerdy. And okay, so just to anticipate some of the results. So this is now casting 10 years of experience. So here, the red area here is the outturn GDP growth in the United States. And the green balls here are forecasts produced by expert judgment. In this case, it's survey professional forecast, very correlated with the Green Book, the Fed staff forecast. You know, they did quite a good job. Okay, in during the expansion, they were pretty good. You know, after a while, they realized there was a recession. They got it well. Also, during the recovery, doing pretty well. Now, why you want to replace these guys with the computer algorithm? So there are different reasons. The first one, as I told you, you know, you have to wait a quarter every time in order to understand what's going on while there is a lot of data out there. And another reason is that, you know, these forecasts can be good, can be accurate, but there is some element that can induce some distortions. Distortion can come from strategic interaction between forecasters. You know, you don't want to be different from the others, so that you have herding behavior. Another reason is mood. So forecasters, so you know, human judgment can be great, but you know, we are affected by moods, okay? And mood can be dangerous. So I think this is a good example of how mood can distort the forecast. Here we are in 2001. There was a recession that was dated by the MBR committee starting at the beginning of the year. And then the trough of the recession was dated to be the third quarter. You know, these guys, the forecasters, didn't get it. Okay, you see these three balls here, they were predicting positive growth. And then, just when the recession ended, they started forecasting a recession. This was the effect of 9/11. Okay, now, the computer machine, what will do is this job here. So it's a machine that will compute this forecast continuously, okay? And this is the result. This is putting this machine in real time. And actually what you see here is that it's a sort of joining these dots. So, and it's very much in line with judgment. So it means that, you know, you can make a forecast that is as accurate, but it turns out also to be very correlated with judgment. So you are able to replicate with the machine what these judgmental forecasts were doing. Most importantly, since it's a machine, you can run it every minute, okay? And this means that you don't have to wait, you know, every quarter, you know, because why the forecasts are updated infrequently? Because these people have to meet, they have to discuss, and so on. With the machine, instead, you can join these dots. And so this is, so I think this graph here, I hope it convinces you that what I'm gonna show you will work. Okay, so how to construct this computer algorithm? So the way is we did it is to learn from markets. And actually if you go on, so market, what did the market do? They obsessively monitor macroeconomic data releases. You know, if you go on a trading floor, there are these guys with a lot of screens in front of them. And one of these screens they have is a Bloomberg screen where there are all the single data releases that are going to appear during the day. They have exact hours. And so they obsessively do this. And what happens is that, you know, the information about the economy is conveyed by official releases. And the market participants form expectations about these reports. And when realization are different from these, they do you have a news? And typically markets, if you have a news that is sizable, market react to this. Stock prices go up or down, and interest rates and so on. So this is a screen that is not exactly, this I downloaded from the web. It's from Bloomberg.com. It's a calendar of data releases next week. You know, you have important releases. You're going to have the industrial production release. Then look, people look at inventories. You know, there are a lot of, there is a Bloomberg Comfort Index. Then a leading indicator we have been hearing today, and so on. So here is an example of a release that of last week. Actually, it's considered one of the most important data releases in the United States, is the employment report. And so the consensus is the forecast made by this forecaster. People were forecasting 150,000 more job creation. 150 new job created, and the range was between 100 and 200, and the actual was 165. So there was a positive news that was commented on the media. And so this was the April job report. It was good news for the stocks. Bonds prices went down. And so this is a plot of this data about non-farm payrolls, and this yellow line here are the forecasts that were made by the markets. The difference between the two are news to which market reacts. So here are a few quotes from the newspapers. You know, every time, like, they also, for example, there were weak job reports in August. It was released in September, 7th of September. This was a comment about the fact that this might induce the Fed to do a new stimulus, and indeed they did quantitative easing 3. So this kind of high frequency data are also important for the implementation of monetary policy. Okay, so we are gonna mimic exactly what the markets do. And how to do this? Very simply, we will just go take out of the shelf state-of-the-art macroeconomic models, reduced form macro models. And so we will construct a joint model for all the data that are released throughout, continuously released. And we'll update this model in real time, accordingly to the real time data flow. And so this is going to be model-based forecast, so free of judgment, mood heeding, as I said before. Herding, sorry. And interestingly, what we are going to do as a byproduct, we are going to translate the news on the markets in a common unit. And essentially, this common unit is going to be gross domestic product. So, you know, you will have, for example, in the employment report, you have a news about unemployment, which is a rate of unemployment, and then the number of jobs created. So these are two different units of measure. So what I'm going to show to you is we'll provide a way to translate them in a common measure. So how to do this? Very, let's try to slightly formalize it. So here I denote by YQ a target variable, here in this case, gross domestic product, growth at time t. Omega v is a vintage of data that are available in a specific moment. V is the moment in which you collected this data. And this data contain quarterly, monthly, possibly weekly, daily data. And okay, so what is a nowcast? It's just the projection of our target variable onto this information set. Okay, so far is essentially the same as forecast. What makes the difference with respect to forecast is are the characteristics of this omega. And what are these characteristics? First of all, it has jagged edges. What does it mean, jagged edges? It means, you know, today we have employment data for in the United States up to April. Industrial production, we still have up to March because it's going to be released April in a week. So in a sense, you have sort of missing data at the end of your data set. That's jagged edges. Moreover, it contains mixed frequency. You have GDP, which is quarterly. Industrial production, that is monthly. Weekly claim, that are weekly, and so on. And third, it could be large. Why it's large? Because you have a lot of data releases that the market look at that. And moreover, what you have to do, you can update this projection anytime new data are released. So when new data are released, you have this information, omega v, that becomes omega v plus 1. It can be after 5 minutes, for example. And interestingly, this index here, that the index for the vintages is different from the index of time. This is what makes the difference with traditional forecast. And these intervals, so the interval between two consecutive data releases are short and also irregularly spaced. Okay, so when there is a new data release, as I said, the information set expands. Why? For example, in a week we will have industrial production for April, we will have a new number into our data set. And interestingly, what you can do, you can decompose you can look at the difference between the new forecast and the old forecast. And actually, you can rewrite this revision, this forecast revision, as a weighted sum of all the news that are happening between time v and time v plus 1. So what happens within v and v plus 1, a certain set of variables are released. The difference with respect to what you were predicting for that variable is the news. And then you have a weights attached to this. What are these weights? They are essentially, it's the Kalman gain. It's the same way it works, the Kalman gain. Here there is a complication due to the fact that in these cases, the vintage and time is different, but it's just a technical. Okay, so now what we have to do is just to compute this projection, update them, and look at these weights. Which kind of model you have to use? So first of all, in order to have this neat interpretation in terms of news and weighted news for your updates, you need a model that is able to make forecasts for your input variables and also for the target. Second, it has to be estimated on many series while retaining parsimony. While many series, again, markets look at many, many variables. They are obsessed with the many data releases. And third, this model need to handle jagged edges, mixed frequency, missed data, and so on. How to do this? Extremely simple. Just get a parsimonious model that can be cast in the state space. The Kalman filter techniques will do it for you. This is a set of, just to convince you that the kind of variable people look at can be large. So this is the important data releases in the United States for this week, next week, and so on. So there are many data. So what is a model that has this characteristic? An example is a dynamic factor model. We have heard a lot about this. So you have, essentially here, you gain parsimony by exploiting the fact that macro data can move a lot. If they can move a lot, you can think that there is a common factors that is driving all of them. And then you model this common factor as VAR here of order P. So this model is parsimonious, robust for big data. There has been a lot of literature recently showing that this model works extremely well. It can handle a lot of series. Actually, this is a model that turns the curse of dimensionality into a blessing. So a lot of data can be helpful, make the model more robust. And however, there are also other alternatives. So for example, a mixed frequency vector autoregression model could do the same job. You can cast it in a state space form, and then you can use shrinkage, Bayesian prior, in order to make it work with big data. Okay, so how we are gonna handle this? So missing data, you know, you can easily do the missing data within a state space model. Essentially, what you can do is to say, you know, when you don't have a data, just attribute an arbitrary number, and just say that the error in the observation equation is infinity. This will do the job. Mixed frequency is very similar to missing data. Essentially, a lower frequency variable, you can think of it as a temporally aggregated and periodically missing variable. So it's easy to do. Estimation, you can do it with quasi-maximum likelihood. It's robust, feasible, and okay. So this is, okay. One thing, so we are gonna work out this model with the daily data. So this is tedious because, you know, daily, you know, every month has a different number of days and so on, but it's tedious, but you can work it out. It's just a matter of getting nerdy enough. Okay, so let's go to some empirical results. So this is the real-time data flow that we consider. So the target variable is gross domestic product, which is quarterly. And you know the variable we include in the system are variable that markets monitor. So industrial production, purchasing manager index. This is an index, actually, they ask purchasing managers every month, do you think the economy is doing this period better than the period before? Then they take the difference between the people that say it's better and the people that say it's worse. This is a balance of opinion. It's very timely. You get it typically at the end of the month, you already get the month. Then disposable income, employment, housing starts, a bunch of stuff, prices, import experts. Other surveys that people look at, this is similar to this purchasing manager index, but just for the Philadelphia area. This is an interesting survey because even if it's local, it's very timely. So I think next week we will get the survey for the month of May. So it's one of the most timely variable. Then stock, we also include some financial variables, stock price, oil price, the spreads, exchange rate, and so on. Okay, so here is, we just put this data and extract the common factors out of this data set. And then we project the GDP on this common factor. And so this is gross domestic product, while this smoother line here is a daily common factor. Every day you have a sort of a measure of daily GDP. One thing that you can do, you can look over time throughout the quarter and check how your estimate of this common factor improve. Okay, so you know every time here new data arrives, you can get better and better estimates for your daily GDP. And this can be measured by the filter uncertainty. And you see here is an example throughout the quarter. So for example, here we start at the beginning of the quarter. This is April. And then you go throughout the quarter until the end of the quarter, and then one other month until the data releases. And you see that this uncertainty declines. So saying that, you know, there might be some value in updating the forecast often. And here, we divide the data in some categories. The blue line here are the drops associated with the monthly variables. Green is the weekly, and this sort of red here is daily. And you see that most of the drops here are associated with the releases of monthly variables. So weekly and daily variable don't provide interesting information here. Okay, the model at work, this is an art test for this model. So was the model able to forecast the Great Recession? So this is a forecast for the fourth quarter of 2008. So the forecast, we start making the forecast in, think here is October, and then, you know, there are some, and we update it every day, and you see that there is a continuous decline. Okay, there are a set of negative news that are picked up. So here, this is the first news about the month of October, when a first release that was incorporating the expectations after the collapse of Lehman Brothers. So this generated a big drop. Okay, so what you can do now is, okay, this is a specific quarter. So you can look at the different quarters, and then what you can do, actually GDP released is this ball here. It was released only at the beginning, at the end of January 2009, okay? So 4 months after the Lehman Brothers collapse, we could see essentially what happened to the economy. And now what you can do, you can compute the mean square error, how to do this. So this is a special forecast. This is a fixed event forecast. So you are forecasting the same object, but from different horizons. So you can look at the accuracy when you forecast at the beginning of the quarter. So you can do the difference between this point here and this point here. Then you can do for different, then you square, you do it for different quarters, you average. This will tell you the average error in mean square sense for a forecast done at the beginning of the quarter. And then you can do it another time here and so on. And you will have an auto-sample mean square error produced at different point in time. And if you evaluate it, this is the kind of graph you obtain. So this red line here is the accuracy of my grandmother's forecast. GDP growth is 2%. Obviously, there is no value of information. She will never change her mind. It's 2%, and throughout the quarter will be 2%. So the accuracy doesn't improve. This line here is a sort of mimicking what expert judgment was doing, a set of equations, single equation, then average, then so on. You see that, you know, there is some value. So this mean square error declines, but it stays very close to my grandmother's forecast. If on the other end you use the machine I was illustrating to you, then what you obtain is that, just look at this yellow line is a benchmark model, and you see that there is a decline, and there are significant gains with respect to this benchmark. Actually, in the paper, we evaluated these gains, they are significant and so on. And yeah, and here there are some other comparisons in which we compare, for example, with a model with and without financial data, and this confirms that in real-time financial data don't help a lot. And essentially, the reason why they don't help is because they are very volatile. They can be related to the cycle, but they are volatile. So this is the stock price, the growth, the daily return, monthly return, quarterly return, year-on-year returns, and compared with our global factor, with our common factor. And you see that there is some information, but it's a low frequency. At high frequency, there is much. Okay, so let me conclude by saying, so these were the questions I was trying to answer. So how important is now casting relative to longer horizon forecast? So now casting is key. I hope I convince you about that. So there is a little predictability beyond the current quarter. The second question was, can we predict the present? And how relevant is informal judgment? We can predict the present, and there is no need for informal judgment. And finally, how relevant is conjunctural information? How often should we update the forecast? So it's worth to obsessively monitor this conjunctural information, because through time, you improve your the accuracy of your forecast. Something I forgot to comment here. This ball here is the forecast obtained by professional forecasters. So similar accuracy. But you know, these guys cannot exploit this additional information. OK, how much time do we have?
Like 10 minutes.
OK, very good. The interesting thing is that this model is extremely simple. Okay, so it's a factor model with only one factor, and you know, the number of lags in the VAR is just one. It's we put it at the simplest specification in order to avoid the temptation of, you know, data mining and stuff like this. Now, a question is, you know, does this simple model works also for other economies? Actually, I've done a lot of work on the euro area. It works well, UK, it works well. You know, in this industrialized economy, advanced economy, it works pretty well. Now, the challenge, an important challenge for this very simple model is to go and see how did they work with emerging economies. You know, economies like this is the case for China that are fast growing. Remember, the model I showed to you is pretty stupid. It's a linear model, almost stochastic. It's only one factor. So we try to put this model for China, which is a fast growing economy. You might think that there have been a lot of structure. So this is a calendar of data releases that markets watch in China. It's pretty similar to the kind of data that you look at in the United States. Less numerous, but it's similar. So you have surveys, industrial production, GDP. Actually, GDP is very timely in China. It appears after 15 days. So we will have this quarter already at the middle of July. So one thing that you can do, you can extract these common factors up to the, out of this data and compare it with GDP. And here is this common factor extracted in real time. So these are different lines because, you know, it's re-estimated every time. And the stars are the real time estimates compared with GDP. So this is a lighter area is the first vintage of GDP, and this is the revised one. And you see that, you know, this factor extracted with the statistical method out of this heterogeneous variable tracks pretty well GDP growth in China, which is also suggesting that probably data in China are not that bad, unless if they are cheating in producing this data, they are extremely good in cheating. So they are reproducing historical regularities. So you can put this in forecast. Essentially, you do a regression of GDP onto your factors. And this is from 2008. And these are the forecasts produced by the model. This is year-on-year GDP. And okay, the red line is a little bit more sophisticated than my grandmother. It's an autoregressive model of order one. And these diamonds here are the only forecasts that are available, at least that I was able to find on public data, about year-on-year GDP growth in China. They are produced at the end of every year by the IMF. And, you know, they are very infrequent, but it's interesting that, you know, very similar to the kind of forecast produced by this judgment-free machine. Here are some real-time forecast here. So this is a forecast. Yeah, let me skip all this. I move to Brazil. So you can put this also to now cast Brazil. Actually, Brazil is very interesting because I just realized that here there is an obsession about now casting. Here it's I don't know, those of you who know the Sistema di Expectativa de Mercado. So actually, the Central Bank, Banco Central do Brasil, every day goes to the market participants and asks them, what is your forecast for year-on-year growth of GDP? And they do it every day. So every day they collect it. So it's really, they are obsessed with this and now casting. And so what do we try to do here? I will try to run a machine on the data that the market participant look at. Actually, there is a Fundação Getúlio Vargas is also involved in this business. They produce a confidence indicator. Interestingly, there is also a monthly GDP produced by the Banco Central do Brasil. I know that you also have one. I would be interested in putting it in the machine. You know, and these are the typical suspects, the usual suspects. Okay, GDP, industrial production, PMIs, and so on. Okay, so this is year-on-year GDP. The red line is the outer, and these blue dots are the real-time, the daily updates of Banco Central do Brasil. So you can think of this as very sophisticated nowcaster. So I said before, these judgmental forecasts are infrequent. Brazil is the exception. Okay, so let's run a machine in real time at the same moment these guys did, and this is the kind of results you obtain. So it's interesting. So the machine is pretty much replicating what these judgmental forecasters are doing. So here, for example, there are differences. Here the model is doing worse. Okay, is forecasting a deeper recession. Here the model is doing better, so it's getting better the decline. I think both of them provide interesting information, complementary information. An interesting aspect of due to the fact that you can forecast all the variables, then you can look at the news, you know, the importance of this data, and then you can look at these weights, this Kalman gain, and then you can look at how big is this weight associated to each variable. And then you can see what are the important releases. Okay, you can, if you are a market participant, knowing which releases are important is important, because when they are released, better you don't go for a coffee. You stay in front of your computer. Okay, so here is a graph, and it seems that the important one are important exports, PMI, industrial production, employment is important, and so on. This is the index of Getulio Vargas. Doesn't seem to be as important here. But this is a typical situation that we found in many economies. Consumer confidence doesn't help getting the signal in the economy, while other indicators like survey of production are very interesting. So this is, comparing, there are not so many forecasts on year-on-year, so we also wanted to compare with year-on-year forecasts. These are produced by IMF and OECD. And so the IMF is yellow, OECD is blue, and you see that the forecast, essentially what happens is that the forecast produced by the model continuously is joining these dots. This is, I updated yesterday night, and this is the forecast the model is making for 2013. So it's about 3%. I think it's very close to the last numbers of the IMF, because it was moved down from 3.5 to 3. Okay, so this concludes presentation. So thank you for your attention.
Well, thank you very much for your presentation. It was very interesting. Let me ask you something about the way that you treat your data. How do you input data that are completely like in different scales, and are you using variations or especially because you are composing like daily data with monthly data, so are you using like year over year, but how do you do this?
Something, thank you for your question. Something I forgot to discuss is that this model work with stationary data, so all data are transformed to stationarity. So for example, industrial production, we put month-to-month growth for industrial production. For daily data, so what the way we treat daily data, we put them in day over day. Mm-hmm. So like for the stock price, we put the daily return. But then the way we treat this data, we link them to monthly GDP by thinking of monthly GDP as an average over the month of an unobserved daily GDP. That's the slide I went very fast about aggregation. You can think of higher, lower frequency data as temporally aggregation and periodically missing. You can think of GDP industrial production as an average of a daily industrial production that you observe only at the end of the month. That's mm-hmm. the way we treat it.
But do you seasonally adjust the data?
All the data we are using here are the data that the market participants look at. So it means that in the United States, they were seasonally adjusted. For other economies, for example, for China, this was very important. In that case, data are not seasonally adjusted, and what the people look at is year on year. So if you look at the screen of the Bloomberg screen in front of the traders, what they look at is the year on year kind of data.
Hi. Is there any room for imposing restrictions from theory, and do you think that would be could be useful?
Actually, this is something I've been working on, and I'm continuing working on it. Essentially, what one way of doing this is to include what I've been doing. Let me tell you. I have a DSG model, like so completely informed by theory, which is typically is a quarterly frequency. So people make a decision at a quarterly frequency and so on. So what we do, we add to this we have this system, and then we add this conjunctural information. And essentially, the way we add this conjunctural information is a sort of, you know, people in this economy, agents in this economy, can get some new information about the current state of the economy by looking at conjunctural indicators. But this is something I'm working on. And interestingly, since DSG models, you can cast in a state space form, and this all this technology immediately applies. But I think it's extremely important.
So you had a slide about the consensus forecast in Brazil, is that right? And the facto model results? Can you go back to that, please? So these are the average, the cross-section, every day?
Yeah.
And how do you fare, how do you compare with them, the facto model?
So what do we do? Every day, so for example, here, so we get the data that are available today. Okay? We estimate the model, and you make the forecast for your year. When you're doing here, what we are doing, it's out of sample forecasting. You can think of back testing the model. We go here, you can think of, we have this information set omega V. V in that case is gonna be the 1st of April, 2012. So we make sure that we have the same information of the judgmental forecast, and we make the prediction. So these two things are based on the same information set.
Okay.
So it's,
So yours is based on the facto model?
Yeah.
Yeah, that was my question. So how do you compare in root mean square error with them?
So here I didn't compare root mean square errors. But one way of doing, you can do the difference between every point. This is the outturn. You do the difference between the two, square and average. That's a possibility.
That's yeah, I just wanted to know the result.
Ah, I didn't compute it.
It's okay. Yeah.
I didn't see all the data that you use, but I'm not sure if all of the data that you're using were available in real time, not for Brazil, for the U.S. And my guess is that they're not all of them. I don't know. And if they are not, how can you really see what is the performance of the model in real time?
So. Actually, when I first started working on this, this was one of the main criticisms. What I've been trying to do at the time was to do a pseudo-real-time exercise. I didn't have all this real-time data, so what I was trying to do is to mimic more or less the data available. And since there was not in real-time, I didn't have data revisions. Now, in this exercise here, we are fully real-time. And we downloaded this data by Alfred, is the Archival Federal Reserve of St. Louis database. So every day here, we have exactly the data that were available at that time. It's another tedious exercise that I had to do. So these results are really, it's a truly real-time backtesting.
Manufacturing new orders available now in real time?
Sorry?
the manufacturing new orders, durables,
is now available? They are available, yeah. Actually, they did a great job at the St. Louis Fed. They are creating this real-time database for all the data in the United States. So it's from, I think, from 96, and they are increasing over time. So I'm very happy. I was very happy when I saw this new data, because one of the criticisms was, yeah, but you're not really real time. You know, there are a lot of people that are obsessed with real time. Athanasios Orfanides was my discussion, and say, you know, but you are cheating here. If you put real time, it doesn't work. Actually, the result I showed to you show that actually real time here doesn't matter, the revisions.
I run the same model, it does matter a lot. But anyway, you know, when you don't do real time, the fit is really, really good. In real time, it's a total different story.
But this is real time.
This is real, okay. Another question that I have is, okay, you have a lot of variables, but what is the guarantee that you have that some of them are working against the model? I mean, if one is going to one place, another is going to the other place, putting a lot of stuff and then running every day might be counterproductive. How can you account for that, and how are you measuring it?
Actually, this graph tells that actually this is not the case, because you see, every time new data arrive, this forecast becomes more accurate.
Yeah, but that's because it's becoming more, the information is getting closer to the release of GDP, so you're getting more close information.
Yeah, but when you get closer to GDP, it's because there is a new data arriving. So here, every time you move from one point to another, it's really new data arriving. So, for example, if today if I update the model at the end of the day and there is only stock prices included there, so my new forecast will just reflect stock prices. And if it is bad, I would observe an increase here. Actually, it doesn't. It's not the case. There is another reason. Actually, this issue of selecting data in these factor models. You know, when you go big data, then you have the issue. Yeah, but in the end, why don't you put everything? The result of the game yesterday. So here, actually, what we are doing, I didn't have time to discuss, it's in the paper. What we do here, we really mimic the markets. And the markets, you know, they have this screen, and you can look at, you know, the data they look at. And moreover, they also attribute, Bloomberg provides to you also the weight that the market participant put at the particular release. So here, essentially, we put all the variables that the market participants are interested in. Now, if there is a release that is not important, we still put in there because, you know, knowing that is no information is informative, like the consumer confidence. That's
okay, let's think. Domenico.
So, thank you.
So I'd like to thank Vale, Getúlio Vargas Foundation, and the conference organizers. Thank you.